Hi guys, in this new video we want to discuss the most important factors that are influencing active and reactive power transfer in a power system and specifically in a high voltage system. So as usual we will be using our radial grid system and you can see actually the simplified electrical diagram of our system. So we have the sending side, the generator, a series of three inductances, which are the one from the two transformers and the line, and the load on the receiving end. I guess many of you may be familiar with the classic example that is used in the textbook. That is the one of an equivalent system with two system or two generators or two power injection or consumption at two ends, sending and receiving ends, and a series inductance, which could be a line, a transformer, or a series of line transformers, and so on. The mathematical formulation that is that can be derived in a pretty straightforward way applying the classic electrotechnical formulation, so just by calculating the voltage drop on this inductance and by deriving the receiving power as the sum of active and reactive power. So the complex power formulation, we can derive the power seen at the receiving end and the reactive power seen at the receiving end. Both depends, of course, on the magnitude of the voltages, on the value of the reactance, and on the angle of the sending side. Keep in mind that this formulation is assuming that the receiving side has an angle, so the voltage at the receiving side has an angle equal to zero, and that our system does not have any active power loss, so that pretty much here there are no resistances. Also, capacitances are not included, especially if this JX is representing a line, or if they're included, then they should be built, they should be buried inside the Q component of the sending and the receiving end. So let's see now the system in Powerfactory, and of course the point of addressing the formula is also to make everyone aware that the calculation that Powerfactory are doing can be that Powerfactory is doing can be derived also by simply performing hand calculation with the formula that has been just presented. As always, the calculation can be done both in the physical domain, so by using physical values, and also by using per unit values. So the one that I'm reporting in the next few slides are actually taking advantage of the per unit values, because that's easier for making calculation also without any calculator or just by hand. Just keep in mind that in order to simplify the per unit calculation, we need to choose the basis properly. So in this case, we will choose a base power that is a 600 MVA, because that's the size of our generator and our transformers, and a base voltage that is 220 kilovolts. That gives, of course, the possibility of defining the base impedance simply by Ohm law, and then all the other reactances of line and transformer can be derived in per unit values. You may notice that we still have a 20 kilovolt bus. We still have two buses at 20 kilovolt, but in this formulation they can be neglected as long as we just see the transformer from the high voltage side, so that we see the reactance of the transformer, of both transformers, just from the high voltage side. So we remain pretty much on the 220 kilovolt level. So let's get into Powerfactory. I already performed the load flow. You see that, as always, I have set the voltage at 1 per unit and 0 angle at the load side. And the generator is, of course, providing the 120 megawatt necessary. No active power is lost in the system. And as always, as we also saw briefly in the very first lecture, the generator is providing also the necessary amount of reactive power that is consumed by transformer and lines. You may notice that the currents that can be used for the per unit calculation are different. The relative current are different if we looked at the load side and if we looked at the generator side, because the load current here it's normalized on the power value of the load, which in this case is 120 megawatt. That's explained the one per unit. But the absolute value of the current is the same throughout the system because with all elements are just in series, so there is nothing shunt that is deriving any other current value. Of course, the current at the generator is 0.2 per unit because the 120 megawatt is 20% of the complex power of the generator. So if we're going to perform all the calculation per unit, we have to remember that our currents need to be normalized according to the base power, which is 600 megavolt ampere. An interesting feature that PowerFactory offers in this case is the scenario feature, which comes quite handy if we want to flip from one operating point to another operating point without losing the information in our system. So scenario works in a pretty simple way. You can just make a copy of this element under the folder scenario. Maybe we can just give a new name to avoid confusion. You can call it 02. Then we activate the scenario. And pretty much all the information, all the set point, all the values that are in this light blue color are going to be stored in a scenario. So if now we change this value and put 60 megawatt, then we can see that our scenario got this asterisk here because things change in the system and we need to save the new values. That's the only time in PowerFactory when you actually have a save button, because other times all changes that you do in the system are automatically stored in the database. But now we created a new scenario, and if we want just to go back, then we can just reactivate the previous scenarios and we can see that we got the previous reactive power value. So now we are just gonna flip to 120 plus J60 and then see the new result. So in this case we can see that the values of course change, the voltage increased quite significantly, because right now we need to inject much more reactive power in the system. Also keep in mind that the necessary 60 megawatt has the consequence that we need to provide much more reactive power from the generator, because of the 60 megawatt increase the current in the system, and the increase of the current increased also the losses in the transformer, in the line, and in the other transformer as well. So compared to the 17 megawatt that we had before, we had to provide more reactive power all in all in the system. This of course can also be appreciated by looking at the phasor diagram. We can see that our current down here, that's now it's lagging a little bit more than 26 degrees compared to the voltage. We have a 20%, 0.2 per unit active part, and a 0.1 per unit negative part. Again, these per unit values are to be referred to the 600 MVA base of the generator. And now we can appreciate also the voltage drop, which of course is not lying anymore just on the imaginary axis, but we have actually also a real voltage drop. So a voltage drop that is taking into account also a component that is on the real axis. We can see also the last case for this example, which would be the situation where we have the opposite case for the reactive power. So again, we can create a new scenario, just getting a new name. Then we can activate. And then we can also change the values down here. And now we can see that we perform the load flow again. And of course, we're in a situation of excessive amount of capacitive power in the system because of the load being extremely capacitive, which partly gets compensated by the necessary magnetization of transformer and line, but of course the generator needs to cover for the rest. And in order to do that, it needs to lower the voltage because it needs to draw the reactive power. So one thing that you may notice is that the active power, as always, will be flowing from the generator to the load, but actually the reactive power will be flowing from the load to the generator because of that. One thing you may appreciate compared to the previous case is, of course, that the current, this time, the imaginary part got on the first quadrant, and that explain that is the consequence because now the load is capacitive, so the power factor is a leading power factor, so it's plus 26 degrees. And of course, the voltage drop is lying also complementary to before. So now actually we have a voltage drop, also we have a negative voltage drop on the real axis. One thing you may notice also is that the angle actually on the generator had to get a little bit larger compared to before, because right now, since we have a lower voltage, then we have the consequence that in order to move the same amount of active power, we need to displace the voltages at the generator and at the load side a bit more in order to allow this transfer of active power. Just to keep that 9 degrees in mind, and let's just go back to the previous case just to have the result at hand. We can save this one, then we can reactivate the previous one, perform the load flow, and then you see that now the angle was 7.8 degrees. Just to get the same picture for the very first scenario, and that's pretty much halfway. So this makes sense because right now the voltage is somewhere in between the two values. Again, remind the formulation that we have here. So the transfer of the active and reactive power depends heavily on the values, the magnitude of the voltages at the two ends, the inductance, the reactive part of the inductance, and the angle. And if this is not going to change and we are changing the voltage, especially the sending voltage, then in order to transfer the same amount of active power, we of course need to displace the voltage angle. Furthermore, that's about it for this example.